Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage head of GSMA Intelligence, Peter Jarek.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to day two of MWC Los Angeles. How is everyone? Wonderful. So, as it says, my name is Peter Jarek. I'm head of GSMA Intelligence. It's the research and consulting arm of the GSMA, and I'm super excited to be here today for this keynote. We've got a bunch of great speakers, number of great presentations. We're going to hear from Verizon Business, Sprint Business, Boingo. But first, just to get you all ready, to make sure you're all paying attention, I got a number of questions for you. Now, promise it's not a quiz. There's no prize. No one's being tested or judged here. But first question, who did the Sunrise 5K? Anyone? Great. So I can tell. I didn't see any hands go up, which means you had a fun time last night. But it means I can tell you I won. If there was no right, there was no one there to. Great. If there was no one there, I won. It was great. No, it was wonderful. I think if there were people that raised their hand, it was great that you were out there. Wonderful to take advantage of the city and the opportunity. Second question. So, how many of you do you know GSMA Intelligence? Any hands, customers, use our data? I see a few hands, which is great. I ask that for a couple reasons. One, always super thankful for folks who are using our data, using our insights. It's my team's purpose to help you guys understand what's going on in the market, to hear from you, to understand what we should be doing. As part of that, put out a piece of research this week around the mobile economy in North America. Go check it out. It's available for all of you good people. Talks about what's going on in the market today, tomorrow. Encourage you to check it out. Last question before I get off the stage and you hear from the people that you really want to hear from. We've obviously been talking a lot about 5G here. Big topic for the industry. Who here thinks the consumer market is the biggest market for 5G? Maybe the lights, maybe you just don't see that. Who here thinks it's business, the enterprise and business market? So I see a lot more hands, which is, nice, thank you. Great, so I see a lot of hands, which is great, because what we're going to have here today in this keynote is we're going to hear from a lot of great folks talking about what's going on in the enterprise space, right? We're going to be hearing, like I said, from Verizon Business, Sprint Business, but first, I'm really excited to be introducing Mike Finley. Mike Finley, CEO of Boingo, only came in as CEO this year, but came in to help move Boingo into the 5G era, help Boingo enable the 5G era. And with that, let me introduce Mike Finley.
Thanks, Peter.
Thanks, Mike.
Great to see you.
Thank you.
Morning, everybody. Thanks, Peter. Excited to be here to kick off day two. Hello, all of you. And welcome to Los Angeles, Boingo's home turf. Boingo was born here almost 20 years ago now. So you may think of Boingo as Wi-Fi and airports. In fact, our stock symbol is even Wi-Fi. But today we're so much more. We're not just Wi-Fi and airports. We're a total connectivity provider. We partner with venues and we deploy all types of wireless at those venues with our partners, primarily carriers. We deploy 3G, 4G, 5G, Wi-Fi, and now even CBRS as it starts to launch. But we're not just in world-class airports. We also provide connectivity in venues like stadiums, multifamily communities. And probably the one that's the most dear to our heart at Boingo is we're providing connectivity to the servicemen and women where they live, in the barracks, in the military bases around the country and many parts of the world. But you'll find Boingo in iconic locations like the World Trade Center Oculus in New York, Soldier Field in Chicago, and airports from around the globe, London Heathrow, Brazilian airports, and of course right here in our hometown of LA at LAX. And speaking of LA, I have a wonderful guest today, a great friend of mine, and proud to host a discussion with Kathy Schlossman, who's the president and CEO of the Los Angeles Sports and Entertainment Commission. You might hear us refer to that as LASIC in our conversation today. Kathy leads the strategic efforts to bring major events to LA, and wait till you see what's coming. Under her leadership, LA will host a decade of mega sporting events, much of what we're going to talk about today. But before we bring her to stage, we have a video that demonstrates what Kathy and her team have been up to.
Boom. I love Los Angeles. This is our house. Our home sweet home.
The Dodgers do the unbelievable, but then again, they're the Dodgers.
Come pull up a seat. 10 world-class venues. Eleven franchise teams.
Light that baby
touchdown, Rams!
More than any other city in the world.
And it's gonna fall for Ibrahimovic! Oh, come on! Come on!
This is our house. Our blue skies. Our history. Our pride. Our fans, our moments. And it's our future.
In 2028, we're bringing the games back to LA.
The King, he's taken his talent to Los Angeles.
Being able to play for a historic franchise, this is a dream come true for me.
This is our house. It's noisy. It's colorful. It's proud. And everyone is welcome.
Welcome to the show!
Wow, what an incredible video. And with that, I'd like to invite Kathy Schlossman, President and CEO of the Los Angeles Sports and Entertainment Commission, to join me on stage. It's a long walk.
I know. Hello.
Great to see you. Hi. All right. So, Kathy, thanks for joining us. We have the mobile world here today.
On behalf of the L.A. tourism industry, thank you guys for coming back to Los Angeles. Is everybody having a good time in LA?
Always selling. Love it. So we think in this room of the next decade, is 5G. First, before we start, I didn't describe your role. Can you tell me a little bit about what you're doing and how this got formed?
Sure. The Los Angeles Sports and Entertainment Commission was founded about 25 years ago by our mayor, Richard Reardon, to help bring major sporting and entertainment events to Los Angeles. Our job is actually not just to bid on and secure these major events, but to make sure that once they come, they're successful, they're sold out, they have the support throughout the entire city, and they want to come back.
So how do you get these events? How do you get them awarded? What's the process to make that happen?
Right. So the process is not unlike what you would go through in bidding on an airport or major venue. There's an RFP, there's a proposal, there's an in-person presentation, interview, and then they select the cities. But it's very fierce competition to get these events because of the economic impact, the social impact, the media visibility that comes with these events. So the things that they're looking for are first and foremost the primary venue, the stadium. And we have the biggest, I think, competitive advantage right now with SoFi Stadium, the newest state-of-the-art stadium in the country. So the primary venue is important. What people also don't realize is it's not just about the big event. So as an example, for the Super Bowl, there's 20 or 30 other events going on during the week leading up to it. And so they're looking for proposals that include a couple of alternatives for each of those 20 to 30 venues. You have to, as the bid committee, you have to go out and secure those many years ahead of time at an advantageous / free rate for them. The hotel package is important. They want to have a number of hotel rooms. As an example, the Super Bowl is going to book 60,000 hotel room nights, so you have to lock those hotel rooms up in a convenient location, convenient to the venues. Wow. And also, you have to have everything from the economy hotels to the five-star hotels so they can take care of everybody. The events are looking for marketing, promotional, and advertising support, not of the big event, but for everything else they have going on. They're looking for community business leader support, and also they're looking for financial support, private and public. But I think the biggest thing that they're looking for, Mike, is great guest experience. At the end of the day, these are their signature events. Their guests have to have a great time or they're not coming back.
And so what are some of those experiences that they're looking for?
So when I say great guest experience, it has to be from when they arrive to when they leave. So it's not just about the big event that's taking place in the stadium. It's all the other ancillary events that they're going and attending. So they have to have a good hotel location that they can walk to where they're going to or easily get to where they're going to. Transportation plan is key. It's got to be convenient. The airport's got to be good, and you know something about that.
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, that's one of the things that Boingo does. I mean, if you flew into here through LAX, you've seen all the construction, so there's a ton of money being poured into that, as Kathy highlighted, years in advance. But that's where it starts. When they arrive here, you mentioned transportation, how you get around. Mm-hmm. If you've been in LA at all, transportation's pretty hard, but a lot of people...
But getting better.
Getting better, yeah. I'm not sure about that.
But
a lot of people in this room are working on that, autonomous driving and, you know, the experience in hotels. And, you know, at the end of the day, they all want connectivity. When they want to look at their phone or they want to access their device, they want to have
technology. Technology infrastructure has got to be key. And that's part of the public support you have to have. The city has to have invested in all that technology support because, and you guys know this better than we do, that people only notice when you do a bad job. If everybody's connected and everything goes well, they just take that for granted. But if you do a poor job and you've all been at major events where you haven't been able to send pictures or connect out of it and everybody complains and they remember that, and that's not what you want them to walk away. So we are, Los Angeles, the city, is investing a lot in the infrastructure for transportation and for technology to make sure we can host all these major events in the future.
Well, that's great news for all of us in this room, for sure. So let's talk a little bit about technology for a second. The Olympics is coming here. So what role did technology play in getting the Olympics in the bid?
So technology played a huge role in the LA 28th bids team. So I think everybody saw Mayor Garcetti was here yesterday. So the LA 28, we're hosting the 2028 Summer Olympics in Los Angeles. And Casey Wasserman and Mayor Garcetti, they really sold the IOC on the complete guest experience from door to door. So from the minute that you access technology to buy your ticket to when you land at LAX to when you're going to the hotel and to the events, the whole entire experience is going to be powered by technology. And that was a very big selling point. And while it's nothing novel, everybody says, well, of course, it's important and it has to be there. And so that was a big selling point for them. Another thing that I think is interesting is being done already, but what they're going to do for the Olympics here is there's going to be no cars driving to the venues for any of the Olympic events. It's all going to be public transportation. And how they're going to do that is when you go online and buy your ticket, your ticket, while you may think you have a ticket and you can go to the game, your ticket is not valid until you go online and choose your mode of transportation that you're going to take to that event. Now, you can change that later, but that will give the event organizers an opportunity to have enough staffing in different places and know where everybody's coming from so they can manage the guest experience so the lines aren't long and everything is more convenient because they know how people are coming. Right now, they're just guessing, and some of the biggest sports disasters have happened. I remember, not to mention the New York Super Bowl, but they didn't know how many people were going to be on. They didn't have enough staff and trains and stuff available because they didn't know. I mean, how do you know? So this way, they're mandating it for the future. And I think that the last quick story I want to tell on how they use technology is when the bid evaluation committee came to Los Angeles to tour all the different venues. They wanted to make sure they had a good process. You obviously want to show off the best of your city. So our friends at AECOM, who did the whole transportation plan and so much in putting together the bid, they sat down at command headquarters where you can see all the timing of the streetlights.
Yeah.
And so for the whole entire route for the bid evaluation, they made sure and timed all the streetlights so that nobody was stopping. There was no traffic making your way around on a weekday in Los Angeles. Wow. And I think that's great. I mean, that's a competitive advantage that any city could take advantage of. Absolutely. If they have the ability to do it. And that's why technology and infrastructure is so important. You can affect the guest experience in a lot of ways.
So a great use of technology. As I live here, and anybody who lives here in LA, I'd like to get the number of that guy who can fix those streetlights, make it work. And on the ticketing process, I was thinking, I'm pretty sure my mom's not going to be able to get a ticket now to the, if she has to go through all that, or she's going to have to come with me, I guess.
Yeah. Right?
So that's great. So the other thing that's interesting is you, just what happens today, it wasn't that long ago that if you didn't have a paper ticket, you couldn't get into an event. And so we're Clippers ticket holders. And
now it's the reverse, right?
Yeah, you can't even, there's no paper tickets.
Yeah.
You can only do it digitally. And what are some other use cases that you see? Like we in the industry look at, you know, artificial intelligence and voice recognition. You know, some of those benefits come into people that are in the events then once they're there to, you know, understand that maybe the bathroom lines are shorter,
right,
or they can get their food quicker, things like that. Are you seeing anything else like that, or it's coming?
Yeah, so a couple things. I mean, again, nothing, you know, novel, but it is being used. Facial recognition was used at Staples Center for the NBA All-Star Game in 2018 very effectively. I think that, interestingly, our friends at LA Tourism told me the other day that at the Barcelona, the Mobile World Congress in Barcelona, they learned about how we're not going to be having lines at events anymore, which is a huge
Absolutely.
Problem because technology will allow you to see, you know, what the lines are, what the ideal time is to come, and you can avoid the line. So between that and how they're going to manage transportation in the future, and you said we're just getting rid of all the problems for most of the problems for major events.
Well, and the reality of it is the events. And even if you look at the team owners and that, they want people in the stadium. And so any way the technology can enable that to happen in a more convenient way is going to be positive.
Well, so I think that's a really important point that in the sports business, they call it butts in seats, that the technology industry and through 5G has to figure out how to make the experience in the arena, in the stadium, more compelling than watching it at home. Right. And that is going to be the biggest challenge going forward because it is so fast. There's so much you can get on your television or at home now.
Right.
What is the reason, you know, what is the reason to come? And I know Steve Ballmer with the Clippers is very big in technology and what he's doing and proposing to make sure that he's going to continue to drive, you know, people butts in seats
exactly.
in to watch the games.
And we're also seeing, if you think of like gambling, you know, in legal, like the sports leagues are engaging, the teams are engaging. But it's really going to require a lot of what Boingo does and a lot of our partners do in making it high bandwidth and low latency so you can make that micro bet that says, I think the next shot will be a three. They'll make it, they'll miss it, and things like that. So that's another reason. The only place you're going to be able to do that is in the seat at the stadium.
Which is a great advantage. I mean, any advantage like that comes forward is going to help us with these live events and continuing to track, because that is the biggest concern of all these events is how do we make it more compelling so we're going to continue to drive business to the stadiums and the arenas.
Exactly. So one more question before we go. So why are these events priority for the city of LA?
Right. So I think a couple things to remember on this. Number one, the most obvious one is economic impact. A Super Bowl, as an example, drives $250 to $400 million of economic impact to a city. A second one is the international media visibility that follows these events. Again, using Super Bowl or a World Cup that we'll have in 26 or the Olympics, there is so many credentialed media that come to the city, not just for the event, but they come weeks and months before, and they're looking for stories, and they want to tell stories. So we can use that spotlight to highlight things that we want as a tourism destination, and you can't buy that kind of media. So the media is super important for a tourism destination. And then the last thing is that people forget is the social and the community impact, the job opportunities that come for small and minority-owned businesses, the volunteer opportunities for kids who want to get in the sports business and don't have a way to break in, the participation opportunities, the sense of pride that you get from hosting these events. There's been studies done. They are really important to a community and the growth of the community, and I think that is why it's so important. I think people need to get to look at these events as not just the major event, but everything that happens around it, everything that happens in the community. It's just a great opportunity, and that's why cities compete so fiercely to get those things, and I think we've done a good job. We're calling the decade of opportunity. We have from 2020, we have the Major League Baseball All-Star Game, we have the NCAA Men's West Regionals, we're hosting the Super Bowl in 22, College Football Playoff National Championship in 23, the U.S. Open at LA Country Club
right.
in 23. We'll be one of the host cities for the World Cup in 2026, and then our crown jewel, the Summer Olympics and Paralympic Games in 2028.
Wow. Well, how incredible is that? And Kathy's very humble, but she and her team play a great role in making these things happen.
Well, I have a great board of directors who support our efforts. So.
Well, and as Kathy said, when you think about the technology that's going to be required to make this happen, I think LA is going to become, you know, one of the model cities probably around the world of how we do this. So both personally and professionally, that's good, as you know, the airports will gain improvement and we'll be able to bring technology and all the great things that everybody in this room are doing. So again, we think in terms of the next decade is the 5G era, but in LA, it's really the decade of mega events coming. And Kathy, thanks so much for being here, and thanks for all the work you're doing for Los Angeles.
Thank you for all your support. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thanks, everybody.
So I think for most of us here in the U.S., we probably know on the 5G side of things, we probably know a lot of what Verizon was doing to really lead on 5G. Obviously, going out early, launching some consumer markets, really helping to understand what you can do with 5G. But I think if you're also here, you know that Verizon has a huge focus on business and on the enterprise. So I'm really excited to be moving over from hearing from Boingo to introducing Tammy Irwin. It's EVP and Group CEO of Verizon Business. We'll talk a bit about what they're doing on the business side of things.
Mike and Kathy, thank you very much for allowing us to imagine what 2028 might look like. I have to tell you, the best news I heard was no traffic in LA. So that's pretty spectacular if you can imagine a world with no traffic. Listen, it's a thrill and an honor to be here with all of you at Mobile World Congress. You know, at the beginning of the year, our CEO, Hans Vestberg, delivered a keynote at another major tech event just up I-15 at Las Vegas. And he talked about really what was 5G. And his theme at CES was change everything. And broadly speaking, this meant responding to an era of economic and technological transformation by seizing the opportunity and shaping the direction of change. At a slightly less global level, this also meant changing everything, or almost everything, at Verizon. Preserving the best of who we are, and yet transforming for a new era. That included the reorganization of the company into three big customer-facing units. And by big, well, let's just say that when a company the size of Verizon's magnitude splits into three, we're still not exactly talking boutique-sized businesses. I was given the opportunity to lead the Verizon Business Group. All by itself, the group would be a $30 billion company with over 30,000 employees around the world and be in the Fortune 100. So you might ask, why would we do this? Why would a company like Verizon, which had been doing just fine, go to the trouble of reallocating and redefining our business with so many resources and so many people involved? And the answer for us is relevant not just to the people inside Verizon, but probably more so to all of you. Because it centers on a huge trends that we believe will transform your business in ways that a lot of people, including a lot of very smart business people, have not yet understood. We did it because we had become convinced that the fifth generation wireless networks will indeed change everything. And we knew we needed to act fast to make sure our customers were ready for this change. In the case of Verizon Business Group, that means business customers, large and small. It also includes national, state, and local governments, first responders, and public safety agencies of all kinds. The creation of this group was our way of sending a very strong signal that Verizon is here to play and win in the business sector, that we are committed to giving companies the tools they need to seize the opportunity and shape the direction of change. We call this concept Ready Everything. Let's take a look. Wow. Okay. When you think about where 5G will impact the world, it is certainly in B2B applications, as you heard this morning. Certainly, you can see the potential and be incredibly excited by the future that we're building together. We are excited because 5G business services are already getting companies ready for a new era of digital transformation. That's the core of what Verizon Business Group is offering our customers right now as we prepare to roll out 5G solutions at national and international scale. Because it is clear to us and to a growing number of customers that 5G will fundamentally change businesses' digital transformation journey. This technology will give companies new tools for serving their customers. And yes, it will enable companies to gain efficiency within their own operations. But 5G represents something even bigger. It's not just another G. It's not a sequel to 4G. 5G is so powerful that the best way to think about it is as a wholly new technology. You might even say it's revolutionary. Now, I know that's a word that gets thrown around a lot in the tech sector, but 5G really deserves it. Let me tell you why. Throughout modern history, industrial revolutions have coincided with the arrival of what is called general purpose technologies, innovations that serve as drivers for whole categories of future innovation. If you go back and look, the first industrial revolution was the steam engine. For the second, it was electricity. For the third, it was a personal computer. We're getting a little closer to the world we live in. And now people are talking about a fourth industrial revolution, a new era of virtual reality, augmented reality, the Internet of Things, AI, autonomous vehicles, advanced robotics, 3D printing, and wearable technology. What these and other fourth industrial revolution innovations have in common is an unprecedented level of connectivity between people and people, people and devices, and devices and devices. It's the blending of the physical and the digital in whole new ways. So what is the general purpose technology of this new industrial revolution? It is, of course, the 5G network. After all, in an era that's all about fast, clear connections, the network that makes those connections possible is the key to everything else. So even if you're not ready for 5G today, understanding it is essential for the future. No matter what industry you're in, the network will transform businesses in three very fundamental ways. One way is through sheer connectivity. The ability to connect as never before and to have smart functions at your service in ways you would have never thought possible. A second way 5G will transform business is by providing richly differentiated customer experiences. This emphasis on both customization to the consumer and to the business customer is something we at Verizon totally get. Remember, this was the entire reason we designed Verizon Business Group. And a third is by enabling greater operational efficiency. Industrial IoT, smart meters to track emissions, highly realistic 3D printed prototypes, vastly more immersive and useful video conferencing. We realize that lots of companies are promising 5G these days. But here's what will make Verizon the 5G partner of choice for business. What we call the eight currencies of 5G. These are eight core capabilities that we think customers should demand from their networks in the 5G era. The first of these currencies is very high peak data rate. Your 4G network could transmit data at somewhere between 100 megabits per second and a full gigabit per second. With 5G, throughput will be at least 10 times faster, up to 10 gigabits per second. The second currency is an extremely robust mobile data throughput. In fact, 5G can handle 100 times larger data volumes than anything that has come before. The third currency is all about latency, the time it takes to get a signal from point A to point B. Today's 4G networks have an average latency of about 80 milliseconds. The latency of 5G, under 10 milliseconds. The fourth currency is the ability to connect lots of mobile devices at one time. A 4G LTE advanced network can connect maybe 100,000 devices in a square kilometer. A 5G network can connect over a million devices in that same space. For 5G, currency number five is the ability to keep up with mobile devices moving at very, very high speeds. If you're on a bullet train today or a web-enabled aircraft that goes faster than about 200 miles per hour, make sure you have a good book or a stack of magazines with you, because at that speed, your 4G connection is going to peter out. But with 5G, that won't happen unless you get all the way up to speeds of 300 miles per hour or more. The sixth currency is pretty simple. Service deployment that's faster than ever before, enabling your defined capabilities to be delivered within 90 minutes, thanks to systems made possible by 5G. The seventh currency is something that's becoming more and more important to Verizon and companies around the world: energy efficiency. 5G energy consumption is expected to be only 10% of the usage we currently see today. Finally, the eighth currency is good old rock-solid reliability. 99.99% reliability, something Verizon is known for. Unlike a lot of other carriers, Verizon has been building towards all eight of these currencies for several years now, which is why we're the only company that can offer 5G built right for our business customers. We're already seeing more amazing business applications are possible when all of these currencies come together and are in place. That's because Ready Everything isn't just about the future. It's about what's happening right now. As I've gone around the globe talking with customers of all sizes in all industries about 5G, I've been stunned by the scope of the imagination. For example, Corning has a plant in Hickory, North Carolina, that already has Verizon 5G installed. To explain how 5G will transform the future of this plant, please join me in welcoming Claudio Mazzali, Senior Vice President of Technology for Corning Optical Communications. Good morning.
Good morning, Tammy.
Thank you for being here with us this morning. We are super excited about 5G, as you know, because you've been a really important partner for us as we think about and imagine how manufacturing will change. Tell us what your engineers are working at in the plants in Corning.
Sure. Yeah, as you said, I think 5G will create a more connected, more efficient future in many sectors. Mm-hmm. And manufacturing is one of the key sectors that we're looking at. So joint team of Corning and Verizon engineers are working, exploring the eight currencies that you just described to see how we can transform manufacturing. But we decided not to do that in a lab. So we decided to actually do that in a real manufacturing site, actually one of the largest optical cable plants in the world, one of the plants that are making some of the cables that you use in your optical network to enable 5G. So it's actually a cool cycle that now we are using the 5G to help improve that plant that's making the cables.
Yeah. Fabulous that you're creating that fiber to help us build the 5G, but now you're actually using the currencies of 5G in your current work environment. Tell me some of the use cases that you're beginning to see.
Yeah, we're building this as a very dynamic test bed, so we're going to be testing many different things, but we're starting with three main areas. AGVs, autonomous guided vehicles, that will help us move material across the facility in a more efficient way. Some IoT sensors to help with inventory management, asset management around the plant as well. And the one that I'm really excited is that we are combining the high bandwidth, the high speed of 5G with low latency and some edge computing capabilities to actually bring visual inspection, high-speed video to many other areas of the plant. I think that will help us with preventive maintenance, with quality, and with safety as well. And because we are running this in a real plant, right, we're going to get that feedback extremely fast, and also in a realistic environment where you have, you know, RF interference, you have big pieces of equipment moving around, the production flow shows every day. So I think we're going to get that feedback very quickly from that realistic exercise.
Yeah, what I love that you're doing is you're building it in the manufacturing environment. You're no longer limited by your imagination.
Yes.
And you've just given us 6 or 7 examples of use cases you're using today, and that you're being agile at how you deliver with multiple components of currencies. So tell us why you're now using this in an environment. Tell us why you're most excited about 5G.
Any disruptive technology like 5G is now, I think you start to see the transformation only when you're in the middle of it.
Mm-hmm.
We are just at the beginning right now. But in my simplistic view is that I think there is a lot of hidden data, a lot of lost and hidden data out there.
Mm-hmm.
And the manufacturing environment is one of them. A lot of data that it could be coming from different pieces of equipment,
yeah,
on the manufacturing floor. But it was always difficult or not cost effective to bring that. And I think 5G will allow us,
mm-hmm,
the better capability, the better connectivity capability 5G will allow us to see that data. That's the first step. And I think the next step that will come immediately after that is going to be machine learning algorithms, artificial intelligence algorithms to then use this data and bring that efficient to a totally different level. That's why I'm so excited with this next chapter in our partnership.
Terrific. Well, all that hidden data, and you remind me often, we're just getting started.
Yes.
Thank
absolutely.
You very much for
thank
sharing
much.
Some of what you're working on. I appreciate
thank you.
It.
Thank
all right.
You.
Thank you. Claudio, thank you very much. I'll tell you what, it's awesome to sit and imagine what's possible, but it's even better when you can see it in progress and see the work that's happening and how it's changing things like manufacturing real time. You know, it's partners like Corning, Xerox, JetBlue, and Anthem that we're partnering with to really begin to imagine and to deliver the power of 5G. We're partnering not only with large enterprises, but startups and universities to develop new 5G use cases at our 5 5G labs throughout the US. It's truly an exciting time, especially when you realize we're still in the very, very beginning stages of 5G business applications. Consider the amazing possibilities of multi-access edge compute, or MEC, that hidden data that Claudio spoke about. The ability to bring near zero latency out to the edge of the network, closer to the customer, is going to generate what I believe to be some truly extraordinary business applications. We were the first in the world in mobility. We were the first in the world to deliver fixed wireless. And we see MEC and the related technologies every bit as important as those past breakthroughs. Innovative solutions that meet customer needs and needs they haven't yet envisioned. Think about the way we work from the shop floor to the executive suite. The virtual office will become more capable, more efficient, and I would argue more common. Imagine training for a new job and being able to wave a smartphone over a piece of equipment to get specs or how-to videos on repair and maintenance, inventory information for parts, and so much more. Consider how manufacturing and global supply chains will transform. Everything that Claudio mentioned, plus the complete transformation of the way we make, package, distribute, and reuse products. Anticipate being at your favorite sporting events, and I had no idea LA had as many as they have until we watched the video this morning, and having player stats, facts, and information overlay the games you're watching in real time. That will fill seats. We're already putting that infrastructure in place. For the NFL this season, this means that Verizon lit 13 of the stadiums with 5G for the NFL season, so the stadiums today can deliver exceptional fan experiences to their fans today. And for the NBA's Phoenix Suns, Golden State Warriors, and Denver Nuggets, this means 5G is live in their arenas as of last night. As they start the new season with 7 more arenas that will come online by the end of the season. The pace of technological change is continuing to accelerate and be constantly iterative. All of this highly networked digital transformation is incredibly exciting. But it also makes it even more imperative that we have secure, stable networks that are protected against hacking, malware, and other threats. Verizon Business Group is a trusted partner for managed security services, including proactive near real-time threat detection and mitigation, as well as advanced forensics. We recently acquired ProtectWise, a cloud-based technology that helps our customers get deep visibility into their networks for threat analysis, discovery, and action. Network security and customer privacy are incredibly important. They always have been, and they always will be. Customers know on our 4G network they can expect security. And we have strong measures in place to maintain that security and build on that security and privacy on our 5G network. For Verizon and for me personally, Ready Everything has a meaning that extends to how we interact not just with our customers, but with entire communities. It's about making sure people and communities, all people and communities, are ready to thrive in an unprecedented opportunities and the significant challenges that lay ahead with technology. It means helping towns and cities to be ready to withstand and to recover from wildfires, hurricanes, floods, and other natural disasters. It also means ensuring that students, especially in under-resourced areas, are ready to prosper and participate locally and globally. And finally, it means having a passion for technology's role in improving the way that people live, team, work, and play. You know, as a mother of a middle school teacher, I've taken a particular interest in making sure that kids of all ages are ready to excel in STEM subjects and occupations. If we can't reach those kids, if we can't narrow the digital divide, they won't be ready to thrive in the years to come. And our nation won't be ready either. That's why Verizon Innovative Learning and the New York City Media Lab launched the 5G EdTech Challenge last year, a joint initiative to bring cutting-edge technologies into underserved schools. Judges from education and startup communities picked 10 outstanding organizations. Each one of them got $100,000 to develop their ideas. And of the 10 winners, the judges chose 5 to collaborate directly with Verizon on the goal of giving students new ways of learning and the opportunity to create whole new worlds. One of our challenge winners, Visceral Science, is giving students opportunities to interact with atoms and particles and even build simulated planets with their own orbital patterns. I think that's pretty exciting. And the first 5G classroom has already opened its doors in Cleveland, Ohio, and will be live in 100 more by the end of 2021. Change everything, ready everything. You might say that for Verizon, everything matters. And so it does. We know that businesses we serve need to be ready for the digital transformation that is underway. We know we can help through our technology, our expertise, and our suite of solutions. I'd like to thank all of you for being here today. And on behalf of Verizon, please know we are so excited about the opportunity to imagine the possibilities of tomorrow with you, even as we continue to deliver for the business of today. Thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of the conference and have a great day.
Thanks, Tammy. So several years ago, I was lucky enough to be part of a group of analysts that was flown out to Kansas City, and it was to hear a bit about Sprint Business and really what it was doing going forward. Now, it wasn't just your normal sort of update. It was really to highlight a new focus on Sprint Business for the company, including some new people to come in and change that business. And so I think it's been fun over the last few years to watch how that business has evolved. And that's why I'm happy at this point to be introducing our last keynote speaker, Jan Geldmacher, president of Sprint Business.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for having me here today. Well, we were supposed to see a video here that shows the impact of 5G that we have rolled out over the last couple of months. We made a promise in Barcelona at the Mobile World Congress just at the beginning of this year to deliver our 5G network. And we have done it. We have delivered on our promise, and we have delivered also here in the beautiful city of LA. Now I would like to go into my presentation talking about the merger. Of course, that is in our mind all the time, and I think it is very important for the industry, and it's very important for the United States of America. The merger is progressing. We have come a long way. We have received, in the meantime, all the federal approvals that are required. First, we got the approval of the Committee for Foreign Investments in the United States, CFIUS, for safety reasons. That was very important. National security, very important. We got that approval very fast. We also have an agreement. We found an agreement with the antitrust division of the Department of Justice. And it was announced that the deal was approved. And just recently, you may have read in the press that officially last week, the FCC has also approved our deal. So we're looking forward to the deal, but we are not yet there. We are facing opposition of right now about 16 state attorney generals that are trying to stop the merger with the Department of Justice, and we are expecting a lawsuit on December 9th and a decision in due course. We are still very optimistic that we get the right approval from the judge here as well, and we can continue with the merger. Okay, that's for an update on this very important topic. I would like today not only look at Sprint Business, I want to start with 5G. 5G has a very, very big impact on what we do. Therefore, 5G is a topic of this presentation, obviously. But I also want to look into how we bring together artificial intelligence and IoT, and how 5G spices that convergence that is happening in this area, especially for the business part of what Sprint does. And I also want to look into the very exciting and awesome ecosystem, the intellectual property that SoftBank Group brings together through their investments in artificial intelligence companies, in robotics companies, and other technology-driven companies. And I want to show up how we benefit, how our customers benefit from that intellectual property that we bring to the game here. Okay, let's start with 5G. 5G is going to be revolutionary. We have heard that. It's going to be a very rich mobile experience. We will see smart cities. We will see remote healthcare. We will see safer transportation. And already today, you can see that gaming, entertainment, IoT, or business applications are very much influenced by 5G. So it's an awesome and exciting journey that we are going to start with the launch of 5G. In our case, it's a true mobile 5G that we have brought to the United States here. Now, we all know that only the merger between T-Mobile and Sprint will truly deliver a nationwide coverage, because you have to bring 5G not only into the cities and within the city to some hot spots. You need to bring 5G across the nation. Smaller cities, and specifically rural America, deserves to be connected through 5G overall. And that is something that the merger will deliver. And how will the merger deliver that? It will deliver that by combining the very rich spectrum holding that both companies have, the 600 megahertz spectrum that T-Mobile owns, and the 2.5 gigahertz spectrum that Sprint owns. So at the beginning of the rollout of 5G, we are not dependent at all on millimeter wave. And we can come up with a network that covers the entire nation, that travels long and supports the rural areas, but also supports the metropolitan areas in the big cities in the United States. So that combination of spectrum will make us deliver 5G in a very, very short period of time across the United States. And we will have the highest capacity, 400 megahertz of total spectrum, and the combined company will have 8 times more total capacity in 2024 than the single entities will have or would have. So that's very exciting to bring together these two spectrum holdings and deliver a very low cost price per or cost per gigabit, which means that we can give that to our customers by lowering the prices. So that is, of course, combined with a huge investment that we are going to take. So $40 billion of investment is what the new T-Mobile, in the combination with Sprint, will bring into the infrastructure and roll out the infrastructure across the United States. So what have we done so far? We have already launched 5G, and when I say 5G, I mean true mobile 5G, in 9 cities across the United States. And it's not just hotspots within those cities, it's the territory of the city. And I invite you all to go onto our webpage and look at the coverage maps that we have published here to show where we have coverage for 5G. Already today, we cover 16 million people in the United States in these 9 cities. Atlanta, Chicago, Dallas, Fort Worth, Houston, Kansas City, of course, Los Angeles here, New York, New York City, and the airports, Phoenix, and Washington, D.C. So that's tremendous what our technology team has done here by rolling out a massive MIMO technology that provides dual connectivity so that we can densify our 4G network and at the same time prepare for switching on 5G when the densification is done. And we have done that in just a few months. And if you want to learn more about that, please visit the presentation of my CTO colleague in the CTO session later today. Dr. John Saw will go into much more detail on this. So the massive MIMO technology allows us to create coverage in those cities, and we are already benefiting from that. So what is worth a network if you don't have the devices to use that network? And we have launched a very rich portfolio of 5G devices that are available in our stores and online. Of course, it's the new OnePlus that we have launched just recently. It's the Samsung Galaxy S10 5G, and it's the LG V50 that we have launched. And in addition to that, we also have launched the HTC 5G Hub. With a rich offer of entertainment, like Amazon Prime, of Hulu, Tidal, or HD streaming, we are supporting the 5G experience, and we create greater reliability, a better throughput, a high capacity, and last but not least, a lower latency. And why is lower latency also important in the consumer segment? You see when you switch to the gaming industry. We also support on our 5G phones Hatch. Hatch Gaming is a library of games, very exciting video games that you can play on your smartphone. And when you play a game on your smartphone and the app is actually processing in the cloud and you want to play real time with many players around the world, you need low latency, and that experience is great. Why is that important? Because the gaming industry is really a huge and big event in the United States. The gaming industry represents a market of about $30 billion in the US already today. If you compare that to the traditional Hollywood box office, that's only in high commerce $12 billion. So, and if you think gaming is just something for the kids, that's wrong. The average age of a gamer is 33 years in the US. Did you know that? So that's exciting, I think. And if you look into the 93% of the US households that own a smartphone, already 50% of them do video games on their smartphones. So you see that 5G will enable entertainment and gaming with a very low latency experience, a high quality experience. You play your game on your smartphone, but the game is processed not on your smartphone, it's in the cloud, and the signal travels in no time because of the low latency. So that's exciting. But now let's go to business. Sprint Business executes against a strategy of connecting people, places, and things. We run at Sprint a global wireline network, connects about 150 countries around the world, and we connect the locations of our enterprise customers wherever they are, wherever they will go. We are there with our network. Of course, we also run a rich wireless network, again, with 5G, mobile 5G, and we have launched our IoT Curiosity network just recently in order to be able to support the IoT growth case that we're seeing. My theory is, and I think it's proven in practice in many, many cases, that these three disciplines, connecting people, places, and things, are converging. Everything is software-defined going forward, and therefore it makes so much sense to execute against that strategy. 5G networks will revolutionize the way we use artificial intelligence, and IoT. It will be a whole new way of developing business models and developing new applications. And we see that coming, that IoT networks need to be made for software, because the new applications are software-based. And if you think about what artificial intelligence will deliver, artificial intelligence will deliver new applications in the robotics area. Artificial intelligence will deliver new applications in the autonomous area. So that's all enabled through AI, IoT, and leveraging 5G and their specific KPIs that we will discuss going on. So we have launched Curiosity IoT Network. The Curiosity IoT Network is a 100% dedicated IoT network. It is distributed, and it's completely virtualized. Why do we do that? We have a dedicated network because we want to separate the traffic, the IoT traffic, from the mobile phone traffic, because the IoT traffic behaves different than the mobile phone traffic. We have distributed our network in order to be as close to the customer as possible, in order to overcome the latency issues that are pure geography. Speed of light is something that we can't compensate. Therefore, being close to the customer is important. And virtualizing the network is important in order to be able to roll out new applications and new services in no time. We also have launched the Curiosity operating system in order to allow our customers to manage data, gleaning data from sensors and manage it and transforming it into intelligence. And this is what the Curiosity IoT suite is all about. In order to bring all of that to life, we have only yesterday made a very exciting announcement. We announced our partnership with ASU, Arizona State University. And we are launching something that is exciting not only for us, it's of course also exciting for ASU, exciting for the students, and exciting for the city of Phoenix, for the city of Phoenix in Arizona, and for 22 additional cities that the Arizona State University covers with their curriculum. We also have agreed with the Arizona State University that we jointly invest into research and development in order to use the high innovation power of the university, combine it with the technology power that Sprint brings to the table, and come up with new business models. And we are also very proud that we are the first that have launched a Curiosity University, a curriculum to engage and educate our engineers, but not only our engineers, to help, you know, fostering people that can live with the new digital opportunities that 5G will bring, IoT will bring together with 5G and artificial intelligence. So super exciting about this partnership, and we will bring not only education and R&D, we also will power the city of Phoenix together with ASU with smart city applications, and probably going into the 22 cities even in a smart region or smart state environment. So super exciting announcement. Also, a couple of weeks ago, we opened up our Curiosity Lab together with Peachtree Corners in the city of Peachtree Corners close to Atlanta. Peachtree Corners is benefiting from our 5G footprint in Atlanta, and Peachtree Corner has a very huge 1.5-mile autonomous test drive track where we can test autonomous applications in public transportation. By the way, this Olli bus here, a 3D printed bus, fully autonomous driving, was my personal first autonomous driving experience. And I can tell you, the step is very small, and it feels really safe when you're in it. So if you have the opportunity to do that, it's not a big step. It's a small step, and you feel immediately how well that is conducted and how well that is working. So I invite everybody to test it out. So the 500 acres test bed that Peachtree Corners brings to life allows us to bring real applications, new applications, startups, and innovators and developers into a real test environment. What's so exciting also about Peachtree Corners is that it crosses public streets so that you can use new applications in a test artificial environment, but also you can introduce it to public street environments. So super exciting announcement that we have done here and the launch that we have done just recently. Now, I want to talk about the SoftBank and Sprint ecosystem. That many of you know that SoftBank is the main shareholder of Sprint, And SoftBank has also invested into many companies and many AI companies and robotics companies that are very exciting startups, very exciting intellectual property that we bring together here. And Sprint is leveraging that IP and the SoftBank Vision Fund and the artificial intelligence-based companies that we bring to life. Because we all know that IoT is an ecosystem. You cannot deliver that alone as a carrier. You need an ecosystem of applications and supporting instruments and tools. Now, bring you a couple of examples of what we are doing here. Give you one example, which is Reef. Reef is an exciting company that owns about 5,000 parking lots in the United States. So you would say, what is a parking lot and has that to do with artificial intelligence? Well, first of all, you want to deliver a digital parking experience where the app provides an offer to you based on the supply that a parking lot can offer. So the whole process of parking is about to be digitized and optimized. But it's not only that. Parking lots, in particular, are in very strategic areas of the cities. And being there in the digital world means you have logistic hubs, you have edge computing hubs, you have potentially drone landing and starting positions. So all of that we bring to life together with Reef. Very exciting partnership. Arm, the chip company, helps us to secure our IoT offering from chip to the cloud. Changing a profile of a SIM card over the air is secured by Arm and done by Arm. Arm is a SoftBank investment. And last but not least, Cloud Minds, a robotics company that really revolutionizes the way we will see robots interacting with humans. And here I want to come back to the low latency discussion we had earlier. If you think about it, what's the big advantage of a human over a robot? It's the proximity of the brain to the body. Now, if you can connect a robot to a data center, to the cloud, in a latency that mirrors the human latency that we have, eyesight to the brain, 10 milliseconds latency to 20 milliseconds round trip. If you can mirror that through 5G, a low latency that mirrors the latency of a human body connecting to the brain, you can bring intelligence into the robot and allow the robot to work hand in glove with humans. And Cloud Minds has the vision that by 2025, we would see many, many robots, service robots in households in the United States, and we are powering that in the partnership with 5G. So, super exciting journey that we are on. Now, I believe the world will be disrupted with 5G. We know about technology and how technology is evolving already today. We don't know 100% how the technology is applied. And there's lots of new business models coming up through 5G. And therefore, it's so important that we not only roll out 5G in some hotspots in cities or some metropolitan areas, it's so important that we enable the United States to run their new business life, new businesses, new startups, new ideas on a countrywide, on a nationwide 5G network. There will be disruption, and if we are launching 5G faster than everybody else, we will be the disruptors in the United States, and that's what we are all here for. Thank you very much for your attention, and enjoy the rest of the show.
Great, thank you everyone. As you can tell by the chairs being brought out, we're now ready to have our panel. So what I think is interesting is, what we've heard so far this morning is a lot of the promise, a lot of the expectations of what we're going to be doing with 5G, with the next generation, in the 5G era. But obviously the promises of capacity and latency and the new services have to be enabled by some folks. Which is why I'm happy to be now having a panel of basically industry suppliers, ecosystem players, who will talk a bit about how we take some of those promises, the stuff that we heard about this morning, and maybe put it into context and make it real. So with that, let me take my seat and we can bring on our panelists. Thanks, please. look at that, in order. So we've only got 18 minutes and a little bit of extra time, so I'm not going to take too much time introducing folks here, but we've got Asha from Intel, Bijoy from Mavenir, and Ricky from Nokia. Thank you guys for joining me today. We've heard a lot about the promise of what we can do with next generation technologies from an enterprise side of things from some great speakers today. But let me just take a quick step back, and we'll start. Obviously, you all can chime in, but we'll start with you, Asha. When you come to a conference like this, right, we hear all these promises, and I think across all of the sessions this morning, we heard, here's what we're going to do with latency, and we're going to leverage things like AI and IoT, and 5G is going to help us do all these things. And to some extent, it can seem a bit like a cliche, right? Like everyone mm-hmm. just uses these terms together. And I think I saw it was a prominent VC who tweeted that anytime he hears someone talk about AI, IoT, and smart cities, he knows they don't know what they're talking about, right? Because it's just throwing out some jargon there. But from your perspective, obviously what you guys are doing at Intel, you've been doing a lot on the 5G front. You've been doing a lot on the AI front. Is there a way to pull those all together? Does it make sense to pull those all together? Or are they really disparate things that shouldn't be talked about as a cliche?
So actually, it's a really great question. And I think even the use cases for all of these technologies are similar. And the reason they all kind of get munched together or they're intersecting is because the promise of 5G is the things that enable a fully connected mobile intelligent society. What they all have in common is data and networks. And so the way I think of how we pull this all together is we power the network. Like Intel used to power PCs, then the cloud, and the network. And because we have all of these together, and I love Tammy's 8 currencies, so you can start cutting the wire when you have like latency and flexibility with the reliability, which means the AI then uses those pipes to build personalization and customization. And then we remove constraints to businesses. And then there's like AI, which edge, I guess our edge is the edge. So sure. I think they all just come together.
I mean, Bijoy, Ricky, are you seeing that from your customers, from operators? Are they seeing how those all come together to do what they want to do?
Sure. First of all, thanks for the opportunity. I think as Tammy and Sprint also mentioned, 5G is not just a new generation. It's a think of it as a network transformation. So every time you're talking about network transformation, a bunch of things needs to come together to make it happen. So if you look at how operators have to transform themselves from just being communication service providers to the digital service providers, as was presented earlier, you're going through a network transformation, that stage. So infrastructure transition to web scale, cultural changes within the organization, and then as a technology and as you're playing new roles in the value chain, that means you need to take care of things like AI, which is going to play a significant role, especially you're talking about Industry 4.0. Artificial intelligence of things then becomes very key, especially as we go forward into 2020. So we see what we call these two triple A's, the AI, the artificial intelligence, the analytics and automation. These three things as key elements to make 5G successful.
Yeah, look, I think from a Nokia perspective, you know, we are building these networks. And if you take a step back and think about our history in this through Bell Labs, you know, we helped define the architecture around 5G. And so you see all this stuff coming together. And we're in a fairly unique position of being someone who provides actually all those elements in the network today. And the challenge really is how do we bring that together and actually make it work? Because it is complex, it is new. And things have come together at a point now where through artificial intelligence and through orchestration, we can actually start to make these things real and move data and loads around the network seamlessly, where in the past that wasn't possible.
It's not just a bunch of technologies thrown together. They're things that you need to have to actually execute on the promises.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, one of the things, and it'd be interesting to hear from you, Ricky, and you, Bijoy, in terms of what you're seeing with your customers, but we obviously heard a big focus here on the enterprise, right? What Sprint's doing, what Boingo can do as we think about connected stadiums and venues, what Verizon's doing. And it's clear why the operators want to focus there, right? It's a new opportunity. How are you seeing that with your customers? And if we think about drilling down below the enterprise to verticals, yeah. Do you see the operators having a good enough understanding of the requirements of the enterprise? Or can you help them on that journey?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think one of the things that we've found, if you think about enterprise, I mean, and verticals, it's huge, right? And I don't think anyone can be an expert in all of those things, right? It's just simply not possible. So I think what we've seen really is two types of strategies. One, which is a broader connectivity-based strategy, which is enable enterprises and verticals to connect and make use of the networks. A good example of that would be our Wing platform, which is a global IoT platform, which one of the large US operators is using. So they can provide IoT connectivity anywhere in the world, irrespective of the vertical that's using it. But then we do see that certain operators are focusing very much on certain industrial segments and verticals. For example, we do a lot of work with some operators in Latin America focused on mining and agriculture. We've got some here in the US, of course, very much focused around automotive sectors who have a long history in providing data in the automotive space. So I see it as a bit of both, broad connectivity and very specialized expertise. And how do we help? Well, we're investing a lot of money in our enterprise channel in actually building R&D and solutions for the enterprise space. And helping build ecosystems. Again, you can't be all things to everybody in this space. And what we're learning that's a little bit different to perhaps how we built 4G is having to work with a lot of other players in the industry to come together, bring their expertise. Because even in Nokia, we've only chosen five or six verticals as our specialty. And it's a whole new language that we're learning, a whole new way of doing business and understanding their business challenges. So we have to bring that to the operators as well.
I'd say when we look at the space, understanding the different vertical industry requirements and scale requires greater collaboration. And the good thing is, as operators, we see them actually engage a wider variety of these stakeholders. It's not just talking to infrastructure vendors like Nokia, Ericsson, Mavenir, and others. It's also engaging the industry vertical experts. It's understanding their requirements and eventually being able to translate those requirements into new product service offerings. Specifically to your question on understanding these requirements, if we look at it, you could broadly categorize them into the operational, the performance-related ones, and the functional ones. So operational performance ones, if we look at those, to some extent you could say is understood by the operators. But if you look at the functional requirements specific to certain vertical industries, that's where we think greater collaboration needs to happen among the operators to understand what the different vertical industries need. Because, again, strategic focus is going to be key in selecting the right target sectors, because you go after every sector, you end up losing money. And where specifically Mavenir is helping in this, I'll point to a couple of examples on launches that we did recently. At India Mobile Congress, we announced our partnership with Vodafone Idea, one of the largest carriers in the world with more than 400 million subs. What we launched there was a cloud platform, which is automated, and their objective is to launch it as network as a service. And if you look at enterprise verticals and how vertical industries could eventually monetize this, this is a perfect example of how you could open up your network to third parties, to enterprises, to MVNOs, using technologies such as network slicing and others to eventually generate and monetize the network.
Yeah, I think you go back, it is a little bit of the age-old discussion we had, let's say, around IoT with IT versus OT, right? We can understand the IT requirements, the networking side of things, but there's the operational side of things that will vary from manufacturing to utilities. I mean, Asha, obviously, Intel knows you work with these verticals, you work with these enterprises. Do you think there's a disconnect there? Or do you think we can actually, whether it's through working with integrators, pulling them in, help the mobile industry to make sure they actually meet those requirements?
I actually think it's a work in progress, and we're very focused on it. In fact, we have entire efforts around engaging the trials, like Ricky was telling, learning the language and all. They don't do bits per bytes per second per meter square and all. But we are making progress and removing constraints. Back to cutting the wires and the flexibility it provides, we start making the deployment models easier. We have a network builders community of 350 companies, ISVs, OSVs, comms, costs, everyone, right, TEMs. And so we all come together to look at how do we do the workloads, how do we build all of this together. So it's something that is a community effort, and it's the transition to making the deployment models change the verticals.
So it's interesting, just pivoting a little bit, right? You talk about some of the work you're doing with network builders as a community effort. On a different topic, right, we heard Tammy talk a bit about what we can think of going forward with 5G and technologies to not just serve commercial purposes, but to help communities, right? And to some extent, that's also a vertical requirement, right? Whether it's smart cities or public safety, or you think about education. I mean, how are you seeing with the customers you're engaging with or with the market this focus on technology, 5G for maybe societal good versus just we need to figure out making the business model make sense? Do we need to get the business model sorted before we can think about how we leverage these technologies to help everyone and uplift societies? Or is there a real opportunity to change things? And that's really for anyone who's
Maybe I'll mm-hmm. go first. I think the straight answer to us it is yes. You need to sort out the business case, look at it from a location by location basis. So most of the initial engagements we've seen operators engage in is in industrial manufacturing cases or automotive industry. So you could, for those, if you look at 5G hotspots as the initial use case, and make the business case work, and then you could expand after that. Versus if you try to build a full macro network on day one that's justified on latency use case that's not proven yet, then you end up losing money down the road. So, but at the same time, if you're asking about looking at the greater benefits, you need to look at the greater scope as well, because if you're trying to model 5G and the economic benefits of that, without looking at the greater benefits, you end up losing money, because as all the panelists in the earlier presentations also had, if you don't just see it as a network generation technology transition, but looking at it as a network transformation that encompasses all areas of business, then absolutely you need to look at these greater benefits as well.
Yeah. I mean, if you can remember, we have very advanced LTE networks. I know we wanted to talk about 5G, but the reality is the bulk of where the traffic's going to sit for a few more years yet is going to be in the LTE network. So a lot of the things we're doing are actually already building on top of LTE, LTE Advanced, and allowing us to go out to the cities and work with them in terms of, you know, building smart cities and connectivity and autonomous vehicles, all that sort of thing. It's great stuff. So we can do it in parallel. We don't have to wait for 5G. 5G is going to bring some incredible things on top that we can't perhaps do today at scale or economically. But let's not lose sight of the fact that we don't have to wait for 5G. There's a lot we can still do in the interim.
I'm always reminded that anytime we update our forecast, right, and we look forward to our forecast to 2025, and yeah, it's incredible that 2025, we expect 15-20% of connections to be on 5G, but that's a fraction of what will be on LTE, right? And I think we lose sight of the fact that LTE is, I mean, it's such a solid technology and will continue to evolve
exactly.
and provide some opportunity.
Yeah, but I like to think about the world beyond phones and the other currencies of 5G. I like to think that technology is predictable, but what people do with it is not. And that's where it's all about removing the constraints. I'd go back to your first question. With AI, you get personalization. So when I look at aging populations and things like telemedicine, we can give custom medicine that reduces the cost of the doctor's visits and hospitals and mobility. So I think they all start coming together because of the currencies of 5G. And in fact, your first question of the cliche will actually be what makes it different from LTE and all of it.
Yeah, I think the 5G has certainly brought that conversation to the forefront. And it's not just about the big cities. I mean, we've been doing work with some of the operators here in the U.S. in the rural cities and the smaller places where, you know, you can start to see the benefits of the technology. So it's not just all about also doing it in the big cities. It's going to be a great increment to providing services in rural parts of America as well.
Yeah, I think of the way we've been looking at it is thinking of 5G obviously as an extension, but going back to this idea that what 4G and LTE enabled, right, was a platform on which innovation could take place, right? That we might not have the Airbnbs and the Ubers of the world mm-hmm. if we didn't have that foundation. And so going forward, how can we look at that as a way to not just enable bigger pockets or improve our financial welfare, but look at that as a platform to think about societal change as well?
Yeah, we don't need faster videos of cats. We need real change, right?
We need more. I mean, we need more videos of cats, or at least we need networks because we obviously can't stop those videos from being produced. So I think we've got just about 5 minutes left, and I think what I'd like to ask each of you is, obviously at a show like this where there's a ton going on, right? Lots of different booths, lots of different suppliers here, no shortage of presentations. It's easy to sort of lose sight of some of the cool stuff that's taking place. So taking out what you're showing in your own booth, or you're doing in your own company, what's one thing that you've been excited either to see that you haven't had a chance to see yet, or you've seen while you've been here, maybe as a tip for the rest of us?
I'll start. JWR Wireless, CBRS. CBRS working, and the things that enable mid-band in the U.S.
You can elaborate. We still have 5 minutes.
I'll let the others go and then.
I think I didn't get a lot of time to walk around the floor, but a couple of things that interested me was, of course, seeing more of what edge computing is coming to reality. So I saw one of the booths where you had retail stores where you could just walk in and grab something off the shelf and walk out. And this was for these convenience stores that are not open after after night during midnight hours, right? So I thought that was an interesting use case for how edge computing could be used. And also the opportunity you talked about 4G continuing to play a significant role in carrying most of the data through the next couple of years. If we think about this opportunity for operators, if the number of local data centers that they have in terms of thousands of those local data centers, those dwarf the number of availability zones that the public cloud providers have today. So in terms of actually monetizing this network and having interesting use cases that affect the society at the end of the day is going to be valuable to all of us as a society, especially if you're trying to get rid of the rural divide in the country that's already there for even for 4G.
Yeah, I think I can quickly, before we hand over to you, Ricky, I think I can attest, having moderated a session on Edge yesterday and another one today, Edge is clearly a topic that is huge here. CBRS, we're seeing the initial commercial deployments mm-hmm. not too long ago. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we were hoping that we would have seen those last year at Mobile World Congress at MWC Los Angeles, but it's here now. So that's clearly two big things. Hopefully, you all have seen that. If not, please go take a look. Ricky, what do you think?
Yeah, haven't had a chance to get out of the booth yet, but no, what I always like to do at these shows is go beyond the traditional handset devices and go and see what else has been connected to the networks, because that shows that where the innovation is coming from. So connected devices, connected tools, entertainment. So how are people thinking about utilizing the 5G technology? So there's some just crazy stuff that's going to be out there that you never think about. Going back to the earlier point is that we didn't think of the Airbnbs and these other things when we built 4G. But I think already people are starting to think about, well, what could 5G bring to us? So I think there's already early innovations coming. And it's always great to go out and see what kind of crazy stuff's out there.
Yeah,
not sure if it ever makes money, but there's some pretty cool stuff.
No, but I mean, I think that's the question of experimentation, right? That the experimentations that we saw on the app side of things, what we should be able to see going forward on 5G, that is, I think it's what we're all looking for. So, any last thoughts before we hand it back?
Make 5G a reality.
Yeah, we're just busy building. Exciting times.
I guess that then one last question for me is next year. I mean, hopefully we'll all be here next year. Where do you think we'll be with 5G next year?
I think we'll continue to build on the edge, right? Next year will be all about how the network provides different experiences, whether you're a business or whether you're in a household, around personalization. Next year, I think we'll make that cliche come through with live examples of how the network brings all these things together.
I think that's a great thought.
I was looking at the theme for the conference, intelligent connectivity. I was at the India Mobile Congress last week, and there they had three eyes in there: immersive, intelligence, and inclusiveness. So inclusiveness there meant not just bringing the urban areas, but bringing the rural areas also into the whole ecosystem, making them succeed as well. So I'm seeing increasingly, and I'm expecting next year as well, as 5G rollouts happen, we should hear more of that in the discussions.
Yeah, I think by this time next year, we should really start to see some true traction in terms of the industrialization and in the enterprise space. I think it's still very early days, lots of trials. We need to work out how we help the operators and others that are coming into the business, perhaps through CBRS. How do we productize this in such a way that we can make it economical to deploy quickly so that not every new opportunity is a custom build? I think that's something hopefully within 12 months, we'll start to have some momentum behind doing that.
Wonderful. Well, with that, let me say thank you to the panel, but thank you to you all for being here. I've been asked to give a reminder of one right after this in just a few minutes. I think it's 15 minutes. There'll be the CTO panel, a CTO session. So please stick around for that. Obviously, reach out to us if you have any questions about what we've been talking about. I can just put in a quick plug. My team is running a seminar on private wireless networks. As we think about the enterprise side of things and what we can see with 5G or 4G today, we think private networks are a huge opportunity. Check it out on the agenda. Please show up if you'd like to check it out. But with that, can we have a round of applause for the panelists?
Thank you.
Great. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.